you. Council President Harrell, members of the Seattle City Council, City Attorney Holmes, department directors, and residents of the city. It is an honor to once again be here in these chambers for my third State of the City address. Today, the State of the City reflects the 21st century dreams of the 1962 World's Fair, a vibrant city driven by technology and science, creating jobs and innovation in everything from transportation to healthcare. The State of the City also reflects our worst fears from the Great Depression, as issues of homelessness and inequity continue despite decades of efforts on the part of this city to resolve them. In his book, The New Geography of Jobs, Enrico Morte writes, "Seattle is a place that mixes a strong sense of community with a contagious entrepreneurial energy and an understated cosmopolitan vibe. Above all, it exudes a quiet confidence about the future, a confidence rooted in one simple fact. Seattle has completely transformed itself from a decaying old economy provincial town into one of the world's preeminent innovative hubs. In the process, its residents have become some of the most creative and best paid workers in the United States. Indeed, our median income is at an all-time high, and it is the third highest of any city in the nation. We are the sixth most educated city in America. 59% of our workforce has a bachelor's degree or higher, and we are attracting talent from all over the world. We created more than 63,000 jobs over the last 5 years, with an unemployment rate that is below 3.5%. We have been named the best city in the nation to find a job. Seattle is being transformed by an engine of change, fueled by the same large and disruptive forces that are upending social orders all across the globe. And today, we are presented with a fundamental question. Is a knowledge-based, technology-driven economy going to drive equity in this city, or is it going to drive us apart? Since my last State of the City address, our city's minimum wage has increased to $13 an hour. We have opened up the Office of Labor Standards to enforce it. The Seattle Pre-K program opened its first classroom to more than 250 3- and 4-year-olds. We have made the largest expansion in bus transit since Metro was created in the 1970s, and we have committed to a goal of 50,000 new jobs, including 20,000 for low and moderate income people over the next 10 years. These are our many answers to this fundamental question. In my inaugural address, I talked about our city's challenges around equity and expressed my confidence in our government's ability to address them. I did not pledge a government would be the sole solution, but rather would work with the community as an incubator for solutions. And during my time as mayor, at a pace the city is perhaps not used to, we have taken a vigorous approach to these challenges. To the returning council members, I want to thank you for the collaborative model we have developed over the past 2 years. Even though we have disagreed on occasion, we have shown how progressives can get things done. To the new council members, first, congratulations. And while I know that we too will disagree from time to time, I look forward to partnering with you and continuing to advance the policies that reflect our core progressive values. For city government to be responsive to our changing city and serve all residents justly and equitably, it must mirror the dynamism of our city. Where we see disparities arise within our innovation economy, we must drive with an innovative government for solutions. And we are doing this by collecting and using data to better understand all city operations, using data to set goals, to measure our performance against those goals, adjusting our policies and funding models to be more responsive to changes on the ground, driving more transparency and accountability, and ultimately, as a result, producing more effective projects and better results in people's lives. In my State of the City address last year, I announced Performance Seattle, an accountability tool to allow the public to measure the success of city government. Our public website, which is now up, has posted 86 goals and measurements across departments, answering questions like, are we repairing potholes quickly enough? Are we increasing residential energy efficiency? Are we responding quickly to customer calls? 1 year later, I'm happy to report that for a full 71% of the goals, we are meeting or exceeding our targets. We are close on another 13%. Yet, for the 16% of our goals, we clearly have more work to do. Our task now is to look at the goals, look at the data, dig into it, and determine how we create innovative solutions to ensure that we succeed in all those goals. In another innovation, the Department of Transportation has created a new dashboard for all of its major capital projects to better monitor budgets, timelines, and spending, and make the appropriate adjustments in real time. And we have made the same tool available to the public at capitalprojects.seattle.gov. Today, I am pleased to announce that I am issuing an executive order for all departments to follow a new open data policy that was developed by our Department of Innovative Information Technology in partnership with the University of Washington, the Sunlight Foundation, and our civic technology community. Our open data policy is closely tied to our city privacy program because we recognize the importance of protecting the public's privacy while we release data. This is what a data-driven commitment to transparency looks like. In this and many of the other incredible services we offer as a city are made possible by the hardworking, the dedicated, and the innovative city employees of Seattle. Seattle is among the three fastest growing cities in the nation. This growth has provided us with a booming economy, but it also we see a growing number of cars clogging our streets and a skyrocketing demand for a limited supply of housing, driving up home prices. This spring, I will send to council my draft comprehensive plan. This administration's vision for how to plan for expected growth in Seattle between now and 2035. The main goal of the comprehensive plan is to guide the physical development of our city. However, the plan must promote better access to jobs, transit, education, affordable housing and parks, community centers, and healthy food for all of our residents. That is why this year's comprehensive plan has a new and unprecedented emphasis on equity, with goals across every element of the plan. But I also know that it is not enough to set goals in a planning document. I have ordered my departments to integrate this plan with new accountability metrics and policies to work with our most vulnerable communities and make decisions based on data about existing disparities so that we can respond before displacement pressures become even greater. I fear that if we wait too long, we will lose our history and we will lose our soul. Last year, we created the Office of Planning and Community Development to better integrate the planning of city investments, including investments made by our Parks District, our preschool transit, transportation, and housing levies. We launched this effort for the first time in Lake City, where last week, Councilmember Juarez joined me in announcing a comprehensive community plan to make Lake City a walkable, livable, vibrant neighborhood. Woo! I know we share a vision for a better Lake City. and I look forward to working with her on this new approach. Our approach in Lake City integrates and connects new park space funded by our Parks District, new classrooms funded by the Seattle Preschool Program, increased bus service funded by our transit levy, new affordable housing on city lands at Fire Station 39 funded by the housing levy, and 20 blocks of new sidewalks funded by Move Seattle.
Woo, sidewalks. We got a supporter.
Sidewalks.
I would like to take a moment to acknowledge the current director of this new integrated planning approach, Diane Sugimura. Diane has been working for the city for 38 years. She has served under six mayors and has been the director of the city's Department of Planning and Development for the last 13 years. When I first came to office, she was getting ready to retire from city service, but agreed to stay on during my transition. Then, as I directed our planning department to move forward with a new strategy to grow equitably, she agreed to stay and lead that effort. Then last year, when I announced the creation of a new planning office, she graciously agreed to delay her well-deserved retirement for a third time to get this new department up and running. Diane, I am pleased to announce I have found yet another policy initiative so that you will stay with us longer. Just kidding. Sort of. Diane, it has been an honor to work with you when I was on council staff many years ago, and to work with you these last 2 years. So on behalf of a grateful city, thank you. Would you please stand and be acknowledged? Thank you. Our integrated approach to planning is even more essential after voters approve the largest investment in transportation infrastructure in our city's history. Growing equitably and sustainably means getting transportation right. And Move Seattle is our biggest tool. This includes building sidewalks, repairing roads and bridges, and creating transit corridors. With Move Seattle, we are also furthering our commitment to freight mobility and the heavy haul corridor with improvements at Lander and East Marginal Way. To address the mobility challenges in our downtown core, we are partnering with the Downtown Seattle Association, King County Metro, and Sound Transit to develop a comprehensive center city mobility plan, which we will issue later this summer. Last year, by launching Vision Zero, an innovative strategy driven by data and focus on eliminating traffic deaths, we reduced fatalities by 25%, reaching an all-time low for the city. And this year, we will continue using education, engineering, and enforcement to bring that number down even further. Like the previous year, 2016 is shaping up to be a big year for transit in Seattle. The first Hill streetcar opened last month. Last week, the Center City Connector streetcar project was recommended for a $75 million grant in President Obama's 2017 budget. Next month, two new Sound Transit light rail stations will open on Capitol Hill and at Husky Stadium, providing an 8-minute trip between the university and downtown. This spring, we will see the final installment of our increased bus transit service approved by the voters in 2014. And we will continue to work with the region to ensure that Sound Transit 3 includes light rail from Ballard to West Seattle. And I ask you to join me in ensuring that Sound Transit 3 passes at the ballot this November. I cannot think of a deeper value among Seattleites than the notion that Seattle is a place for all. We cannot allow it to become a place affordable only to the affluent and the privileged. We have to get housing affordability right. This has been a centerpiece of my administration, and I know it is an important issue to the council as well, particularly Councilmember O'Brien, who has helped move this issue forward, and Councilmember Johnson, who will play an important role as the new chair of the council's Planning, Land Use, and Zoning Committee. There is no single way to accomplish this, but the innovative approach we have developed together, I believe, is a model not just for this city, but for the nation, about how to grow affordably when we grow as a city. Our approach means that for the first time ever, we will require all new development in our urban villages to contribute to affordability. All multifamily residential buildings and all commercial development must build or pay for affordable housing. And in exchange, we will allow an extra floor or two of height in our urban villages. This is the heart of the grand bargain. Our approach means that we are working with the legislature to create an incentive for landlords to preserve affordable rents in existing buildings. This will help working families to stay in their homes instead of having landlords raise their rents and displace them. And I'm happy to announce that the Senate, the Republican-controlled Senate, passed that bill today out of the Senate.
Wow.
There's hope. Our approach means also improving tenant security, which is why we are working with Councilmember Swant to strengthen protections for renters with landlords who allow their properties to fall below acceptable standards. Our approach means that through our utility discount program, low-income families should receive a 50% discount on their bills. In my first months in office, I committed to doubling enrollment in this program to 28,000 by 2018. Today, I am pleased to announce that through a first-of-its-kind partnership with the Seattle Housing Authority, we will auto-enroll over 10,000 tenants by mid-year, bringing us past our ambitious goal a full 2 years ahead of schedule. Our approach means renewing and expanding the Seattle Housing Levy. This is the most important step we can take this year to ensure housing affordability in Seattle. And I am working closely with Councilmember Burgess to double the levy in order to build more affordable housing for people like Al Corpella. Al lived on Capitol Hill for decades. Al was a caregiver, caring for those who were dying of HIV/AIDS. He never made much money, but he was committed to a career of service to others. When Al retired, he was lucky enough to find a home in an affordable building for seniors in the neighborhood he loves. But shortly after he moved in, the building was put up for sale. He worried a new landlord would renovate the building and raise the rents, pricing him out of his new home. He and his fellow tenants urged Capitol Hill Housing to use housing levy funds to purchase the building. And now, these affordable apartments for seniors will be preserved for the next 50 years. Al, I want to thank you for your service to those in need and for sharing your story. Would you please stand and be recognized? Part of our affordability agenda is ensuring that all people get paid fairly. It was the first step we committed to increasing our minimum wage, which in particular will help women and people of color who are disproportionately represented among low-wage workers. Also, we know that having a secure schedule of hours helps workers plan their budget, plan for childcare, enroll in school, or take a second job. And we know schedule predictability will most help low-wage hourly workers. This year, we will work with labor, we will work with our community, we will work with progressive employers and the council, especially council members Gonzalez and Herbold, to provide new guidelines for secure scheduling for larger employers. We also need to ensure equal pay for equal work. In America, women earn 78 cents to every dollar a man earns. And these gaps are bigger for women in the Seattle region. I am proud to say that the city is partnering with the Seattle Metropolitan Chamber of Commerce and the Women's Funding Alliance in the 100% Talent Initiative, a regional effort to identify best employer practices to reduce gender inequity. Thanks to funding through our Office of Civil Rights, this initiative will include a special emphasis on addressing inequities faced by women of color. But even as we partner regionally, we can look to improve our own practices as an employer, both on pay equity and our recruitment, retention, and training practices to ensure greater success for all city employees. To that end, we are working with council to evaluate all strategies, including extending parental leave, flexible scheduling, and family leave. As a first step this year, I will fulfill a promise I made in my executive order to ensure greater transparency by publishing city pay data online. Affordability, though, is not just a household issue. It is a neighborhood issue faced by the small businesses and cultural spaces that are important to the vibrancy and the identity of our communities. We must take steps to address the affordability challenge of both. We will create a commercial affordability advisory committee to recommend strategies focused on the needs of Seattle's small business owners. This expert committee will advise the city on how to encourage the development and the preservation of commercial spaces for small businesses and keep our neighborhood commercial districts diverse and vibrant. In 2014, we launched the Arts District program to preserve and expand existing cultural spaces in the city. There are currently two districts, including the historic Central Area Arts and Cultural District, which is using the arts to rebuild, identify, and preserve the Central District as the cultural anchor of Seattle's African-American community. And today, I'm announcing a new exciting move that can help both the arts and commercial affordability in the city. SDOT and our Offices of Economic Development, Arts and Culture have worked together on a plan to make the currently empty upper floors of King Street Station available as new public space for Seattle arts and cultural community and affordable space for small businesses. Not only does this create more opportunities for our local artists, it gives thousands of commuters, neighbors, and visitors access to Seattle's art scene and local businesses in a completely new way. The Urban Parks Activation Partnership has also been working to reactivate open space in our urban core. Working with the Alliance for Pioneer Square and the Downtown Seattle Association, this partnership has revitalized Occidental and Westlake Parks, which after years are once again safe and vibrant places to gather, whether you work in an office or whether you are struggling with homelessness. And I am pleased to announce that we are making investments to expand this initiative. And this May, the city will partner with more community organizations in up to 10 additional urban parks. Our work to build thriving urban villages and combine both density and livability with affordable housing and increased transportation is some of the most important work we can do to address climate change, one of the great issues of our time. We simply cannot grow and expect to reduce our carbon output unless we take these important steps to build an affordable, equitable, and livable Seattle. But there are more steps that we must take. Buildings and transportation are the two biggest sources of greenhouse gas emissions in Seattle. Earlier this year, I transmitted legislation that will improve our building energy efficiency through more transparency and improved operations of our buildings. This legislation continues Seattle's tradition of pioneering initiatives to increase energy efficiency. This year, I look forward to working with Councilmember O'Brien to identify steps to make transportation across the city cleaner and more efficient. Pollution in our air is a direct result of our dependence on fossil fuel-powered vehicles. The time is right for us to spread the benefits of our clean, carbon-neutral electricity to Seattle's transportation sector. This year, we will commit to a cleaner transportation system that protects our climate, cleans our air, and strengthens our economy. Public safety is an area where we have made significant progress, yet still have significant challenges. Crime is falling, but not all crime is falling. Under the leadership of Chief O'Toole, crime fell 7% citywide in 2015, including a 30% drop in auto thefts and a 20% drop in crime in Southeast Seattle. The department is using new and innovative strategies, including one to address chronic crime and drug dealing downtown, using a combination of focused enforcement, changes to physical space, and service to those struggling with chronic addiction. The result is dropping crime rates in the city's downtown core. The police department is now developing ways to duplicate this strategy and other strategies to address drug and criminal activity in other neighborhoods. A large percentage of the calls that the police receive is to respond to people in crisis. In fact, the Seattle Police Department predicts that in 2016, it will handle 10,000 calls related to people experiencing a mental health or an addiction-related crisis. As a result, the police department has expanded the crisis response unit, pairing more trained officers with mental health workers to de-escalate these crisis situations. And this training is working. In fact, initial data shows that officers are using force against individuals in crisis less than 2% of the time. And when they do use force, 80% of the time, they use the lowest level of force, even in high-risk situations. The Seattle Police Department has also implemented a strategy to address several disturbing acts of violence and intolerance directed at the LGBTQ community. The department has partnered with businesses throughout Capitol Hill and the city to promote awareness of hate crimes and provide safe places for victims of harassment until officers can arrive. I'm announcing today that we are also partnering with the Seattle schools to make sure that all schools are available as safe places as well. Our recently convened Chinatown International District Public Safety Task Force will help us to identify new and innovative ways for us to address public safety. In seeking to reduce crime, we face a paradox. Seattle has one of the lowest rates of violent crime in the country, yet we struggle with relatively high rates of property crime, in particular car prowls and burglaries. I've heard from residents that they no longer report many crimes because they do not believe the police department will respond. Even with the progress we have made in the past year, much more needs to be done to address property crime. And in response, we have formed a dedicated team focused on bringing property crime rates down. We inherited a 911 response system that is in need of updating to respond to our growing community. and I have directed the Seattle Police Department to overhaul our customer responsiveness and bring this 911 system into the 21st century. And I look forward to Councilmember Gonzalez working with us, and I want to thank her for her leadership on this issue. Although the Seattle Police Department is larger than it has ever been in its history, our police force is still strained. When I came to office, I committed to hiring 100 more officers over attrition during my first term. We are on track to meet that goal, and we are doing it with a significant increase in diversity among recruits. Last year, 30% of the department's hires were people of color. But I recognize that we need more officers for better visibility throughout our city. Today, I'm announcing that we will add 100 additional officers to my original goal for an overall goal of 200 net new officers. This increase will not be free, and I will soon be sending council a proposal to pay for it. While we increase the number of officers by 200, we will be smart about it, ramping up gradually between now and 2019 to ensure that our officers have the necessary guidance, support, and training they need to succeed. The Seattle Police Department has also launched a new online dashboard where Seattleites can find real and unprecedented levels of information about crime in every neighborhood in the city. Safe communities are not provided by the government or the police alone. They are achieved through a collective sense of trust, and we all in this city have a role to play. This collective sense of trust has been weakened in many communities of color all across the nation, who should never have to insist that Black Lives Matter. Let me be clear, the very need to recognize Black Lives Matter is a result of systemic institutional failures to address racism in our society. Even in progressive Seattle, we inherited a police force under a federal consent decree because of patterns of constitutional violations in the use of force and serious concerns about racially biased policing. When I arrived in office, we immediately entered into a collaborative approach with the Federal Monitor and the Civil Rights Division of the U.S. Department of Justice. Together, we are developing best practices to meet and exceed compliance with the consent decree. Compliance with the 2012 consent decree is imperative, and we have reached initial compliance on 8 out of the 9 formal assessments by the Federal Monitor. In assessing public trust, the Federal Monitor Merrick Bob wrote that the Seattle Police Department has not only fully embraced a community-oriented policing approach, but has demonstrated a willingness to engage and join with the community in an effort that is impressive in its focus and shows early signs of success. And later today, the monitor's assessment of our crisis intervention efforts will show the city is in initial compliance. The monitor concludes there is a real and tangible and objective change in the way that the Seattle police are interacting compassionately and with an eye towards treatment with those in crisis. In addition, Attorney General Loretta Lynch and President Barack Obama have praised Seattle for being at the forefront of police reform and for becoming a model for enforcement agencies around the country. We are pleased with this recognition, but there are still challenges ahead. We must and we will ensure that all patrol officers are equipped with body cameras. And I would like to thank Council President Harrell for his pioneering leadership on this issue. We must and we will continue to improve the way that the police department analyzes and uses data on a daily basis. We must, and we will continue to work to build trust between the police department and all of Seattle's diverse communities. But fair and compassionate constitutional policing alone will not protect our young fathers, sons, and brothers of color. Like safe communities, success in the lives of our young people is not a provision of government alone, but it is achieved with our community partners, like the United Way of King County and their Reconnecting Youth effort, and the Seattle Foundation's Communities of Opportunity, as well as national initiatives such as My Brother's Keeper, the National Forum on Youth Violence Prevention, and Cities United. For the city's part, we are taking a new approach. Last year, I announced that Seattle was one of 14 cities selected to participate in Bloomberg Philanthropy's Innovation Teams program, which aims to enhance the capacity of city halls to solve intractable urban problems and improve the lives of residents. My first charge to the team was to focus on assessing and addressing the disparities faced by African American and East African males ages 14 to 24. The team began not by developing new policies or designing programs, but by going out into the community and talking with those who live with these issues every day. The innovation team asked, "What is important for you to hear from your city?" A simple question, but what we heard from young Black men was profound. They said that we are not the other, that we are not a problem to be fixed, that we are fathers and brothers and sons, that you see us, that you value us and need us. Through these conversations, the innovation team struck on a powerful truth. The health of Black men is essential to the health of society. In fact, I believe when young Black men are at their best, Seattle is at its best. My vision is that in 10 years, all of Seattle's young peoples will enjoy an opportunity for the benefits that come from a growing city and a growing economy. But this vision can only become a reality if our young people themselves have a vision of a future Seattle that includes them. If their expectations include graduating from high school, working at Amazon or at the port, or creating their own startups. From the innovation team's work, we are taking 5 important steps today to help us realize that vision. First, I am challenging Seattle's employers to help us build a national model for youth employment and empowerment. Last year, we connected 2,000 young people ages 14 to 24 with paid internships and jobs during the summer, a doubling of the previous summer. Our goal this year is to double it again, the number of opportunities to 4,000 jobs this summer, and to expand that program beyond the summer and into the school year. Imagine 4,000 young Seattleites to develop a strong foundation on which to build their careers. 4,000 young people to better position themselves to thrive in an economy that is experiencing increased income inequality and racial inequity. 4,000 lives to be enriched by learning essential skills and having the chance to contribute and experience the kindness of mentors and coworkers. To the business leaders of this city, there is no shortage of opportunities you can provide. And not only will you be helping young people, but you will be supporting the future of your company by training tomorrow's workers. Second, we will work with the council to direct an additional $200,000 to CareerBridge, a proven community-driven program that will put more young Black men ages 18 to 24 on a path to success through job readiness, education, social service, and community support. CareerBridge began as a partnership between the city and community organizations like the Urban League, and has brought new hope to the lives of many, including Carrie Carver. Carrie struggled to find direction and break away from gang affiliations in the central area. But this 24-year-old father wanted a better life for his son. In 2014, CareerBridge provided the training, the inspiration, and the hope that he needed to apply for an apprenticeship with Iron Workers Local 86. And when Carrie could not afford new work boots, CareerBridge helped him get what he needed for his first day on the job. Carrie is now earning a living wage and working hard to build a better life. And Carrie, I'd like you to stand and be recognized. Third, we will work with Seattle colleges to improve college attainment and skills for our young people by creating a college for working adults, which will offer low and moderate income students the opportunity to increase their earnings, embark on a new in-demand career, and improve their skills so that they can succeed in Seattle's economy. Fourth, I am directing our Office of Economic Development to coordinate our city's efforts with the White House's Tech Hire Initiative to connect women and communities of color with accelerated training and our local tech employers. Lastly, we will use a data-driven approach to improve the city's youth violence prevention services and to better coordinate them with what the community really needs. Crime data tells us that the majority of youth violent crimes involve young adult males 18 to 24 years old. But these individuals are not currently being served by our existing services, which is why we will partner with the Center for Children and Youth Justice in South King County to implement a DOJ violence-based model of intervention that will train outreach workers to engage these young men, offer them a positive choice by linking them to school, or to a job, or to training, or to other services they need to succeed. And because we found that 40% of youth violence actually involved violence against a family member, we will create a first of its kind, culturally responsive program, providing trained workers who can work with the youth and with their family to address these violence issues at home, often without ever having to go to court or spend a day in youth detention. Perhaps the greatest challenge we face in addressing the opportunity gap is the persistent disparities in our public education system. If we began our process to raise the minimum wage in my first year and began addressing housing affordability in my second year, let us make this year's great equity challenge finding new ways to close the opportunity gap in our public education system. We've already taken positive steps. We have created the cabinet-level Department of Education and Early Learning, and we are pleased to have a true change agent as its first permanent director. Dwayne Chappelle was responsible for driving incredible outcomes as a principal of Rainier Beach School and is already invigorating our new department. We have launched the Seattle Preschool Program, a program we know will drive better equity outcomes for K-12. And today we are joined by teachers and administrators of the first 15 classrooms of this effort that are going to change this city and change the lives of these young people. I would ask those teachers and their colleagues to stand up and be recognized. And I want to thank thank you all for bringing the preschool kids who sang to us just before we came in here. That was great. Next year we have to have him in the chambers. And as I stated before, the opportunity gap for our young people that they face in our public schools is not just the responsibility of the Seattle School District. These children are all of our children. The responsibility is the responsibility of all of us, and we must not fail them. I'm excited about the level of partnership we have built with Seattle Public Schools in recent years. And I want to thank Superintendent Larry Nyland, and I also want to thank and acknowledge School Board President Betty Patu. Betty, would you stand and be recognized? It is time for a citywide conversation about education, and the school district has agreed to join us. This year, I will convene the first citywide education summit since the Rice administration more than 25 years ago, which resulted in the Family and Education Levy. We will bring together teachers and administrators, parents and students, community partners and businesses to build and unite around a common vision for what an urban public education system can be, with the goal of building both equity and excellence. Let us ensure that all of our students enter kindergarten prepared for success, achieve academically throughout K-12, and graduate prepared for college or for careers. I believe this is a year to do this, and I believe Seattle is ready to make this happen. In recent months, the city has been engaged in a conversation about the growing challenge of homelessness. It has been a major conversation, and because of the incredible complex nature of the issue, a difficult one. But we have not let this difficulty prevent us from taking dramatic action. We declared a state of emergency with King County. We have joined with West Coast mayors to place this issue on the national agenda. We have made major reforms and committed significant new funding for services and shelters. I have said many times before that we cannot solve this problem ourselves, but I believe we can take steps that will change lives for the better. I want to thank this council for its quick action. And in particular, I want to recognize the leadership of Councilmember Bagshaw. Yet, we limit our effectiveness to help those struggling on our streets when we are divided. Our citywide discussion has taken on a divisiveness that I believe only adds to the already overwhelming challenge. As President Obama said last month in his State of the Union address, democracy does require basic bonds of trust between its citizens. It doesn't work if we think people who disagree with us are motivated by malice. Democracy grinds to a halt without a willingness to compromise, or when basic facts are contested, or when we only listen to those who agree with us. Our public life withers when only the most extreme voices get all the attention. I think he was talking about more than Washington, D.C. We have a challenge. I presented what I believe is the middle way forward to addressing this crisis, but I readily admit that I do not have all the answers. And I ask this city to heed the president's call, not to question each other's motivations, but to listen to each other, even when we disagree, to step back from the extremes and to be willing to compromise. I remain hopeful that by working together, we can build a national movement and make progress on this crisis. In closing, I want to share a personal reflection about the challenges ahead. 20 years ago, I took the oath of office for the first time as a member of the Washington State Legislature. It was for me and the people I represented, and many across the state, a moment of great sadness. since the reason I was being sworn in was a tragic death of our state's first out elected official, Cal Anderson, who had recently passed away from AIDS. Over these last 20 years, we have shared moments of great defeat and even greater victory. What was impossible became possible. Possible in the face of unrelenting opposition. But the greatest challenge before us today, as a city and as a nation, remains racism, particularly the painful racism experienced every day by the African American community. While the ways of institutional racism manifest itself are perhaps less visible than they were 50 years ago, they are no less destructive and divisive. On the night that Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. was assassinated, Senator Robert Kennedy gave a speech on the streets of an African American neighborhood in Indianapolis. What he said in many ways reflects the challenges we face today. He said, "Martin Luther King dedicated his life to love and justice between his fellow human beings. He died in that cause. In this difficult day, in this difficult time for the United States, it is perhaps well to ask what kind of nation we are and what direction we want to move in. We can move," he said, "in the direction of a country that has experienced greater polarization. Black people against blacks and whites against whites, filled with hatred towards one another." Or he said, "We can make an effort, as Dr. King did, to understand and to comprehend and to replace that violence, that stain of bloodshed that has spread across our land, when an effort to understand with compassion and with love." Everything we have done as a city, from pre-K to transit funding, from police reform to equity in the environment, including the new proposals I announced today, are the tools this city is using to reduce the barriers of institutional racism. The challenge of racism is so great, we know that more is required. The conversation we must have and the change we must be part of will continue to be difficult and painful. The question today is the same as a half century ago. Will we move towards greater polarization, or will we attempt, as Dr. King urged us, to understand and comprehend, to approach this great divide with compassion and love? I believe if, as a city, we choose the latter, we can contribute to this nation's long journey out of its racist past. Robert Kennedy, who gave that speech just a few weeks before he was assassinated, ended it by reminding us of what the goal of that journey ultimately is. He said, "To make gentle the life of the world." 2 years ago, I said, "Let us begin the next stage of that journey." Today, let us begin, let us continue that journey. Thank you.